just about to be winched up into the canopy up there, 27 metres above the ground. Wish me luck. So I'm going way up in the forest canopy. There's a bit of a breeze blowing. We've got a storm coming through this evening, but I'm just sneaking in before that storm hits. So what this facility is all about is about pushing this forest into the future, into 2050. So I'm up in the canopy at the Birmingham Institute of Forest Research, and it is amazing. So behind me you can see these immense steel towers, and we have several of these rings, and what's happening in these rings is we've got carbon dioxide being pumped out into this forest, and it's free air carbon enrichment. It's a face research experiment. This is an astonishing open air, huge scale experiment to see how forests will respond to climate change and increasing levels of carbon dioxide. I'm about 27 meters above the ground. I'm in a harness, I'm sitting in a seat, and we've got students who do this all day, and they're collecting data about what happens in this forest when it's exposed to high levels of carbon dioxide. That's what this facility, that's what this research is all about. And it was fantastic going up in the canopy, and thank you for stabilising me so I wasn't spinning round and round. How long have you spent up there over the course of your research?
So I've spent quite a lot of time up there. Mostly it's about 12, 14 hours a day, and that's generally across like the spring, the summer, and then sometimes into the autumn. So it's quite a lot of time up there, but it's really important to be able to get those measurements.
So you're a long way away from that idea of a scientist working in a lab. This is your lab?
Yep, this is my lab, and today you were able to go up to where my office is. Up in the tree canopy is where I spend most of my time.
What are you doing then? What are you measuring when you're up there in the canopy?
So I measure the carbon uptake of the leaves. This is really important because the leaves themselves up in the canopy are the interface of atmospheric carbon dioxide and terrestrially stored carbon. So I measure the carbon uptake as well as the water use efficiency of those leaves. So this data is really important and a vital contribution to those climate models that will be using this data to scale up from the leaf measurements that I'm taking to globally predicting the carbon dioxide in the world.
And you're at the point now in your PhD research where you've actually got some data and you've published it. So what are you finding? What have your results shown?
So we found that the mature oak trees, which are the canopy dominant species here, they're taking up and they're responsive to that carbon that we're giving them. So they've increased their carbon uptake by around 30% to the CO2 levels that we're expecting in 2050. We've also found that the nutrient levels in the leaves, so the nitrogen and the carbon, has stayed the same, so it's maintained under the elevated CO2 levels. And what this means is that the nutrients that's been in the soil is able to kind of keep supplying that increase in photosynthesis.
And Anna, I know you're really focused on the trees themselves and their leaves, but you're also thinking about the wider ecosystem, aren't you, and what the changes in the trees mean for everything else.
Yeah.
So how is that impacting?
So the work that I've been doing is essentially the first step in the research, and understanding the carbon uptake will then lead to that cascade of all the other interactions and the forest responses in a forest system. So yes, the data that I'm collecting is the first step, and then we can understand and quantify the actual carbon budget of the forest itself.
Nina, what does your PhD project focus on then?
My PhD project focuses on soil respiration, so carbon dioxide respiration, and also nitrous oxide emissions and methane emissions and uptake. Ultimately, hopefully, account a bit for the global carbon budget.
So you're looking at the response down here on the ground, the soil. You're not working up in the canopy. You're very much focused on what's happening in the soil.
Yeah.
And how are you measuring that?
I have respiration chambers. It's a LICOR 8100 system. It measures carbon dioxide. I also have a PICARO system that measures nitrous oxide and methane. And they're linked up to the chambers. They're all spread around the arrays. and the chambers close for 2 or 8 minutes, and then they measure the buildup of the greenhouse gases.
And what are you actually measuring then? You're measuring these gases in the soil, but what is creating those gases? Presumably it's the trees themselves, but all of the organisms that are associated with them as well.
There are three sources. So you've got the root respiration, and then you've got the microbial community, so fungi and bacteria, that produce these gases. Microbes, much like humans, respire carbon dioxide. Yeah. And then there are different groups of microbes in the soil. Some respire methane or nitrous oxide or take it up.
Yeah.
Very much dependent on soil temperature and moisture as well.
Have you gotten any results yet? Are you able to tell us anything new?
I think so. My hypothesis that there is higher CO2 respiration from the soil under elevated CO2, which is what we saw in the first 2 years. It seems to be flipping around now, so the control plots are showing higher emissions than the elevated CO2 plots.
That's interesting.
Yeah, it's really interesting. I'm not going so far as to say this is it, like this is the new finding, but it is really interesting to see what's happening, whether the microbes are adjusting in the soil, what's happening below ground basically.
So this is really important because we know that carbon dioxide levels are going to increase this century, and we want to know whether trees are just going to carry on absorbing more carbon dioxide but also releasing more of that, or whether actually it does get locked away in the soil.
Yeah, exactly. So it can end up in the tree, can end up in the soil, and then is it being respired again, or does it stay in the soil?
I think it's interesting because walking through a forest, of course, what you notice is the trees above ground, and I think a lot of the time we don't think about what's going on under our feet.
Yeah, when you tell people about studying soil science, they thought, oh, it's just soil, and I'm like, no, there is so much biodiversity below ground, you don't see it.
Do you think soil is considered to be less glamorous than perhaps research up in the canopy?
Possibly. I don't know, someone checked my hands the other day to see if there was mud on them. It wasn't, so they were disappointed. I don't know, it looks less cool, and it's also like less visible because some of the research, not mine necessarily, but literally have root box installed into the soil, so you literally can't see it, but it's there and it's measuring. But to be fair, I like my setup because it's robots and people are fascinated about that, so that's one thing.
So tell me about your research here at Bifor.
Well, yes, mine's multidisciplinary research. It's about tree-soil-water relations under the elevated carbon dioxide.
So what are you measuring and what are you hoping to find out?
Well, it's a big subject, so I'm trying to focus on three key measurement areas of the plant water going through trees. So these mature trees are using water, especially in the middle of the sunny period, they use a lot of water. And so my thought was that there was equipment available to measure the flow of the xylem water up the tree, which is quite exciting.
And so the xylem is the vessel within the tree trunk that is where the water is running up from the roots all the way up to the leaves eventually.
Yes, it's a bit like a hollow tube, but it's made up of lots of tiny segments that are end to end. So it goes all the way up the trunk and eventually ends up at these leaves that are being measured. So that's my main measurement point for the water, to see the flow of water through the stem.
And what has particularly surprised you during your research?
This experiment is probably the most amazing experiment that I could have envisaged doing. I don't think I would have been able to dream of it if I'd sort of started out as a young person, as a biologist. It's just incredibly interesting that we're looking at climate change, such an important question.
Jerry, I've been talking to some of your fantastic PhD researchers here at Bifor, and what's really exciting is that you've got to this point with this research project where you've got some real tangible results coming out.
That's the really exciting thing. And it's been set up, and for 2 years we've been collecting the data and giving the trees more CO2, and now finally we can see that they are collecting more CO2 and they're using it to make more sugars.
And this is just something that you didn't know before we started this project?
We didn't know that these trees would do it. It's a general principle, but now it's happening in an English oak forest, and I think that's really exciting and really helps us predict the future.
How will that data feed into our models of climate change?
Well, I think we've still got a little bit more work to do. We need to know where that carbon goes. Mm. does the tree grow bigger? Does the tree be more resistant to pests? And does it go into the soil?
It's been wonderful to visit the Birmingham Institute of Forest Research today and to spend time in this amazing open air experiment, the free air carbon enrichment experiment, the only one of its kind in the Northern Hemisphere. It was fantastic to ascend up into the canopy and then to talk to our researchers who are already starting to get results which are incredibly meaningful, which will feed into our models of climate change in the future so that we can work out how best to protect our natural environment.